Databricks Asset Bundles are a tool designed to streamline software engineering best practices for data and AI projects. They help manage source control, code review, testing, and continuous integration and continuous deployment by packaging metadata alongside project source files. This bundle defines Databricks resources like jobs, pipelines, models using YAML files, making it easier to structure, test, and deploy projects efficiently. So in this video, I'm going to show you how we can set up Databricks Asset Bundle using VS Code and our Databricks workspace. Let's get started. This is my Microsoft Azure Databricks workspace. Now, in order to follow along in this end-to-end project, you need to have Python and VS Code installed on your laptop. So I've done that already, so I'm not going to be covering that in this episode. So I'm going to open my command prompt and I'm going to check the version of Python installed. So I'm going to type in Python and I'm going to type in dash dash version and press enter. So I've got version 3.12.7 installed. Now I'm going to proceed to install the Databricks CLI in order to be able to authenticate and access our Databricks workspace remotely. So I'm going to type in pip install Databricks-CLI. So I'm going to press enter. Now, if you're doing it for the first time, you're going to see all the packages and the dependency installed for you, but you can see this requirement is already satisfied because I've already done this before, prior to this recording of the video. Now, after we've done that, I'm going to proceed to check the version of the Databricks that I've got installed. So I'm going to type in Databricks dash dash version and press enter. And I can see I've got Databricks CLI v0.252.0 installed. Now, if you install this Databricks CLI, you'll probably see version 18, which is actually lower to what is needed in order to perform the Databricks Asset Bundle. So what I'm going to do is to install the latest Databricks CLI executable release. So for that, I'm going to type in, or you need to type in winget search, and I'm going to type in Databricks. And I'm going to press enter. Now I'm going to see this table. I've got this Databricks CLI, Databricks.DatabrickCLI 0.252.0. So I'm going to go ahead and use the winget again. And I'm going to do install. And I'm going to install Databricks, just like I've got here, .DatabricksCLI. So you can see this is actually a proper case where the first letter is D and then the CLI should be uppercase all through, and I'm going to press enter. So this is going to install the latest version 0.252.0 for you, but for me this is already found, so I don't need to reinstall that again, which is cool. Now after you've done this, you need to go ahead and promote the latest installed CLI in our environment variable. So I'm going to type in environment variable and then click on that. So click on path, double click. So you're going to see the winget installed at the bottom. It's going to be at the bottom of the list like this. But you need to select that and click on move up. And also see it here, select that, move up until it's at the very top. So this is what is needed, the package, the winget backward slash package and so on and so forth. So once you see it at the top, this simply means that when we come back to the command line again, this is going to be executed at the top first. So just click OK. And once you're done, we can go back to check for the Databricks version. So I'm going to type in Databricks, or you need to type in Databricks dash dash version and press enter, and then you will be able to see the 0.252.0, which is cool. Now we need to go ahead and authenticate to our Databricks workspace in order to access it remotely. So for that, we need the host and the personal access token. So for that, I'm going to type in Databricks and I'm going to type in configure. And then for the configure, I'm going to type in dash dash host, and I need to get the host URL. So come back to the web browser and I can see that here. So copy this and then I can return to the command line and I'm going to control V to paste. So space, and we need the token to authenticate. So press enter. Now the personal access token is being required. So I'm going to come back to the web browser. I can go to the top right hand corner, click on settings, and then go to the developer under the user, and then we can see access tokens. Click on manage, generate new token. I'm going to call this one my DAP, and click on generate. I'm going to copy to the clipboard, click on done, come back to the command line, and I can right click. Now this is asterisk in order to secure the access token, which is cool. Press enter. Now we are fully authenticated. Now, in order to be sure, I'm going to just list all the cluster within my Databricks workspace. So I'm going to use Databricks clusters list and press enter. So we can see I've got three clusters, the ID, the names, and the status, whether they are working or terminated. So I've got this Abiola clusters, and I've got these two job clusters, which are currently terminated because I don't want to incur unnecessary costs. So after we've done all of this, we can go on and check the Databricks bundle commands. So for that, let me just clear this, type in CLS, and that clears the content of the command prompt. So type in Databricks, and I want to type in the bundle and press enter. So this is going to show us Databricks Asset Bundle lets you express data, AI, analytics project as code. So we can see all the available commands such as deploy, deployment, destroy, generate, init, open, run, schema, summary, sync, and validate. So we're going to be just covering some of them today. Now you want to go ahead and initialize our Databricks Asset Bundle. So for that, I'm going to type in Databricks bundle. Now don't forget the bundle as a keyword, and then I'm going to type init, which is this command here, which allows us to initialize our bundle templates. So press enter. Now we have this set templates to use. Now we have this default Python, default SQL, dbt SQL, mlops stack. Now I'm going to press enter, and I'm going to provide a name for my project. I'm going to type in my dab_project, and I'm going to press enter. So this is going to ask us whether we want to include a sample notebook in the project. Yes, I'm going to press enter, or yes. And then we want to add a Delta Life Table pipeline. Yes, of course. And then we want to use Python package. Yes, of course. Now, once we type that, we can see all of this workspace to use auto detected. And then we can see my DAB project and so on and so forth. And then we can see the name of our host. So your new project has been created in the my_dab_project directory. Please refer to the README file, which is cool. Now I'm going to go ahead and clear this content again. So after we've cleared the content, now we can go on and access the my_dab_project in our VS Code editor. So for that, I'm going to type in code space dot backward slash, and I'm going to type in the name of the project, my_dab_project, and then another backward slash. So you can see, I'm going to press enter. As soon as I press enter, this automatically launches the VS Code IDE editor. And I can see the name of our project, which is cool. I can see all the other files which are coming up, like Databricks, VS Code, fixtures, and so on and so forth. But the most important one that you need to know is this Databricks.yaml. And this is the key configuration file that contains the name of our bundle, and it points to the YAML files in our resource file, which contains the default job and our Delta Life table. So we can see the name of the bundle is my DAB project, and then we have this UUID. Now this also including the .yaml. Now the .yaml are part of this resources files. When I go to this my DAB project.job.yaml, we can see we have this resource. We have the jobs, and then we have the name, and we've got so many other things such as the task, notebook, task, job cluster. Now we can make some modification to all of this if you have experience in doing all of this. But for now, I just want to cover the basics, but in a future video, we can talk more about that. Now, if you're looking at cost, I can just use this maximum of 2 workers in order not to spend too much of money. And of course, we can also specify our Spark version, our node type ID, and so on and so forth. But for now, I'm going to just maintain this and press S to save with the changes I've made. Now, when I come to the Delta Life table, I can see we have the main pipeline for my DAB project, and then we have this resource, and so on and so forth. Now, I'm going to come back to the Databricks.yaml. Now, in the Databricks.yaml, we have the target, the dev, and the production environment. By default, when we deploy our asset bundle, it is deployed to the development environment, which is the default. You can see this is true. And then this is deployed to our workspace, which can be found here. Now, we can choose to also deploy to our production. Now, in a production environment, of course, we want to probably deploy to the production, all things being equal. Now, you can actually specify a different host name. That is another workspace to be deployed to. And then you can make sure, well, you have to make sure that you have the necessary permissions, and then you provide all the other details. But for now, just want to maintain all of these default settings. Now, after we've done all of this, I'm going to come back to my command line. And by the way, let me talk about this CRS. So basically, I've got this notebook that we just want to create the sample notebook. Now, the sample notebook is actually calling this tax data, top 10 record in this tax data using Spark. And then when I come to our DLT pipeline, this actually, you know, depending on our notebook. So we can see we have this sys.path.append, and we're using spark.config.get, and then we have to provide the bundle.source because it's coming from this notebook. And then when you look at this, we have this function that's been defined, and then we have this function that is performing a filtering on the fair amount column. So we want to check, we want to filter all the fair amount column that are less than 30. So we have the filter function, and then we have this return dlt.read method reading from the taxi raw files, which is coming from here. Okay, so that's sorted. Now I want to come back to our command line. So first, we want to go ahead and access the folder in order to be able to validate and perform any deployment or even run. So for that, I'm going to do cd space dot space, and I'm going to do backward slash, and I'm going to type in my DATABRICK. Now, if you're doing this, please pay attention to what I'm doing here, okay? You can see cd space dot space backward slash in order for this to work. Press enter. Okay, this is actually not working for me. Oh, sorry, there shouldn't be any space here. It should be cd space dot, and then I need a backward slash, and then my DATABRICK, and then make sure you put it back. Yeah, there shouldn't be any space here. Press enter. Now you can see we are now within the DATABRICK file folder. So that's sorted. Now we can go on and run our dbt bundle validate. So for that, I'm going to type in Databricks bundle, and then I want to type in the validate command. Now I'm going to just type in dash t dev. So I want to validate the dev environment, and I'm going to press enter. Now if everything is fine, we're going to see validation okay, absolutely okay. Yeah, so we can see the name of the folder, the target and the workspace, and then the user and the path. Now we can also do the same thing for the production environment. So Databricks bundle validate dash t dot prod, and I'm going to press enter. So you can see everything is working as expected. Now we want to go ahead and deploy our bundle to our dev environment. So for that, I'm going to type in Databricks bundle deploy command. Now if I don't specify dash t dev, this is going to automatically deploy to our dev, but for the sake of argument, I'm going to specify the environment that is the target. So dash t dev, press enter. Now this is going to start building our Python artifact, and this is going to start uploading to our workspace users, and then we can see the email dot bundle main folder / my DATABRICK inner folder, and then we have more folders. So we can see deploying resources, updating deployment state, and this is now completed, which is cool. Now I can come back to my workspace, and I'm going to come to my workspace here, and I can see the dot bundle main folder, which arrived just 12:59, and this is almost the same time. So I'm going to just click on that, and then we can see my dab, and I can expand, and I can see the dev where we deploy to. We can see artifacts and then the files, such as what we can see in this VS Code editor. Now I'm going to come to the workflows, and then I can see under the jobs and pipelines tab, I've got dev Abiola David 1 in this square bracket, and I can see my DATABRICK underscore job. When I click on that, I can see that this is actually in a state that is static. So we can't perform anything here because we've not issued Databricks bundle run. So we can also see the job details, the ID, creator, and so on and so forth. Now, we cannot make any changes to all of this because these are all automatically queued out. Now, I'm going to come to the task and I can see the notebook. So I've got notebook task, refresh pipeline, and the main. Now, when I come back to the workflows, I can go to the Delta Life table. And of course, this is not going to show anything much because, you know, we have, you know, kick off this data asset bundle. So I can see this is actually dev. Of course, when I come to the production, there is nothing, you know, going on. Now, this is actually working as expected. So I'm going to come back here and then we can issue the Databricks bundle run. Now, by the way, we can choose to also deploy the bundle to the production, but just want to see the basic that is deployed to the dev. So I'm going to do Databricks. And I'm going to call the bundle, and then I can issue the run command. Now, if I have more than one project, I can be more specific by providing the name of the project. So I'm going to type in my underscore dab underscore project, and I'm going to do dash t dev. Now, of course, I don't necessarily have to do this, but just to be sure, I'm going to deploy to the development target. And all things being equal, before I click on enter, I'm going to come back to the online that I'm here, come to the workflows. And in the workflows, you can see nothing is actually running for now, okay? It has not been kicked off. So when I come back here and I press enter, so this is going to now kick off the project. I'm actually missing the keyword there. So it should be Databricks bundle run my dab project underscore job, because we have the job. Because when you come back here, we can see we have this my dab project underscore job, so this must be, it must include job, and then dash t dev and press enter. So this should start running. There we go, run URL, and then we can see my host name. And I'm going to wait for some couple of moments, and we can see everything is actually going as expected. So when I come back here, I can just give this a little tap by refreshing the URL, and then we should see the spinning stuff. So this is going to start spinning, and in a couple of minutes or thereabouts, this should give us a successful deployment. And that's how we can perform our Databricks Asset Bundle. It's as simple as that. So this is just running this default notebook and this DLT. So in future video, I'm going to show us how we can perform this using our own real notebook. But for now, I hope you've enjoyed this video and you've understood what Databricks Asset Bundle is all about. So thank you for watching, and please make sure you subscribe to the channel, share this video with your friends, and comment in the section below. Thank you, and bye for now. Cheers.